Hello, my name is Joshua Lynn, and I like music, as I'm sure everyone else does too. On the surface, music is just a bunch of rhythms and notes, but music is much more than that. Some would say that music is the lifeblood of society. It gives people in our society motivation and provides a source of cultural and emotional expression. Others say that music is the gateway into whole new worlds, a look into other people's minds and the content of them. Music to me is the expression of one's inner emotions and a medium that is highly intricate and complex. Now, in the current climate of the music industry, people are beginning to see more and more of a rise in music being taken for granted and not being used the way it should be. With songs such as Gucci Gang and the popularization of diss tracks, the rise of songs used to encourage drugs, gangs, violence, and belittling others is much more apparent. Of course, the spirit is still there, with one's inner emotions being expressed, but it's much more different. In a frantic search away from this, and towards something that I felt really solidified what music should be, I found jazz. Jazz was everything I wanted. It featured improvisational solos from musicians, allowing the soloists to fully express themselves on the spot. It had a rich cultural background. It had virtuous performers and bands that I, as a musician, could appreciate much more. I marveled in the entire world I found, and I wondered, why isn't it more popular today? All the music I was seeing was from about the 1920s to 1960s. What happened to jazz today? Many people now consider jazz to be dead, a music from the long ago era that has lost its luster and doesn't have a point in this modern period of music. Many believe that the jazz scene is still thriving as much as it had before, and that it is far from dead. Through the impact on modern music and the continual evolution and support, jazz is far from a dead music genre. But to illustrate this, we have to go back. The year is 1917. A group of finely dressed men walk into a record studio to record the first jazz recording, Liverly Stable Blues, by the original Dixieland Jazz Band. Although the origins of jazz are heavily disputed, Dixieland jazz is generally where jazz first got its footing. The word jazz first comes from the African-American slang term, jossin, which means energy. This was later developed into the word joss, spelled J-A-S, to describe the early bands playing this style, which later developed into the spelling we know today. Such early jazz performers included Jelly Roll Morton, the original Dixieland Jazz Band, and Buddy Bolden. Each of these artists were incredibly influential in the creation of jazz we know today. As the 1920s rolled in, more and more artists began to practice jazz. Artists such as King Oliver, a bandleader, Sidney Bechet, a clarinetist, and of course, the famous Louis Armstrong. Armstrong's influence reaches outside the regular jazz audience. It reaches out to the modern pop culture, with songs such as La Vie en Rose, The Sunny Side of the Street, What a Wonderful World, and his famous Hot 5 and Hot 7 recordings that influenced jazz heavily. After this, the old tradition of Dixieland jazz fell out of fashion, which led the way for the swing era of jazz. With jazz becoming a more serious medium, people began to take jazz more seriously and thus make larger scale jazz bands. This genre, characterized by big bands and a focus on written music and showmanship, was the most popular era of jazz. Between 1930 and 1945, artists and bandleaders such as Duke Ellington, Count Basie, and Lester Young heavily influenced this important era of jazz, solidifying jazz as more than just a silly music genre. After the swing period, the focus shifted to the individual soloist rather than the whole band. This is known as the bebop era, or simply the bop era. Characterized by small ensembles and a focus on complex melodies and improv, this era between 1945 and 1950 solidified jazz as a heavily complex and difficult music genre. Artists such as Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Bird Parker, Thelonious Monk, and John Coltrane were pioneers in this creative genre of music. The last period while jazz was still considered alive was the cool era. This era was between 1950 and 1960, and was characterized by calm, unhurried approaches to improv and an intricate emphasis on composition. Artists such as Miles Davis, Dave Brubeck, Paul Desmond were innovators in this cool genre of jazz. The genres that followed were hard bop jazz, which had an extensive use of funky dance rhythms, and free jazz, which often had use of just improv. We also had fusion and jazz rock, which was influenced by rock music in the way that it used many more electronic instruments. And then we had eclecticism, which is modern jazz. Eclecticism is characterized by many different things. Things such as the further sophistication of electronic jazz, a resurgence in neo-bop and neo-traditionalism, also known as neoclassicalism, a greater involvement of women in jazz, and the growth of European and world music jazz styles. Such artists influencing modern jazz are Wynton Marsalis, Esperanza Spalding, Chick Corea, and many, many others. With that, that is an overview of jazz's history. But what about the other side of the spectrum? Pop music. What is pop music's history? The term pop music was first used in 1926 to describe a piece of music with popular appeal, and was used more often in the 1950s to describe rock and roll and the newest music genres that were influenced. Since then, the term pop music has been generally used as a term to describe music that appeals to all people. It began with rock and roll in the 1950s and transitioned to surf rock with the Beach Boys. And in the 1960s, Beatlemania hit, where the Beatles dominated the pop music genre. And the 1970s hit with some of the biggest names we know today, with the Jackson 5, Elton John, and Queen. Then the 1980s came quickly after, with Prince and Michael Jackson, and a new focus on electronic and synth sounds. In the 1990s, there was a heavy mix in pop music, with Nirvana, the Spice Girls, and not a single characteristic taking over. That brings us to the 2000s and the 2010s, where the genre is even more confusing. We have more experimental pop music now, featuring more than one genre. We have pop music from other parts of the world, particularly Spanish countries and South Korea. We have rap, generally considered pop music, but doesn't have a popular appeal to all types of people. All of these types of genres could be put under the term pop music, as they have popular appeal for everyone. I would say both of these genres we talked about have a similar idea, where they both encompass many different subgenres within themselves. The idea is that jazz represents music with primarily improv, swing, and blues, while pop music represents music with popular appeal. Now that the definition of these genres has been established, we should discuss the definition of a dead music genre. Or what does it mean to be dead? Jazz music has flirted with popularity from time to time, with the 1920s to 1940s being the time when jazz is the most popular. The percentage of people listening to jazz now is close to 15 to 20% of people, while the percentage of people listening to pop music now is close to 56%. These numbers aren't bad, but definitely show a decline in jazz's previous performance in the music industry. To understand this, let's look at the more reasons why people consider jazz to be dead. Particularly, let's look at what some would consider the face of jazz. Wynton Marsalis is an American trumpeter and bandleader of the internationally acclaimed Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra. He is also the leader of the prestigious Juilliard School of Jazz. Not only this, but he was the de facto speaker and influencer of the neoclassical era, or an era that encouraged the resurgence of bop and traditional jazz. This sort of genre of jazz has a heavy reliance on music that was created in the past or music that has only influence in the blues or swing. He believes that any other form of jazz strays too far away from its cultural origins and sense of community. This would mean that a whole generation of jazz, such as fusion, would go completely ignored by the face of jazz. This conservative view of jazz is what makes a lot of people think that jazz is dead, because this allows progression in the genre. This progression, as shown by the history of jazz, basically defined it and made it popular, so now that it's gone, people believe that jazz is dead. Although the belief that jazz should only be cherished and appreciated in its roots is important, I think it's important for music to progress in some ways. Let's look at other influencers in jazz today. Particularly, let's focus on the musicians who are innovative in their music. Some of the most famous examples I see are people such as Leo P., Kamasi Washington, and older artists such as Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea. If you've been on YouTube, you might have seen a crazy pink-haired man in the subways of New York, playing on the Barry sax. This is Leo Pellegrino, or Leo P, and his distinct pop fusion style can resonate more with a pop music audience. His bands Lucky Chop and Too Many Zoos produce distinct pop and jazz fusion with improv and jazz instruments. Kamasi Washington, although producing many solo albums, is somewhat popular for doing saxophone on Kendrick Lamar's To Pimp a Butterfly. This is another example of how jazz can influence popular music, with jazz influence being found everywhere on To Pimp a Butterfly. Things such as swing, traditional jazz instruments, and jazz phrasing being found on the album, along with it receiving critical acclaim for being heavily experimental and influential in the rap genre. Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea both influenced fusion into jazz, with Herbie introducing funk, with songs such as Watermelon Man, Chameleon, and Cantaloupe Island. Chick Corea gave way to heavy Latin and samba influences in jazz, with songs such as Spin and Armando's Rumba. All of these artists are what a lot of people perceive as jazz in the modern era. Beyond the jazz that Wynton produces at Jazz at Lincoln Center, this type of jazz takes influence from popular music and embraces it in its own way. This is how it's been in the past, with the origins of Dixieland starting the tradition of improv, and the other iterations of jazz adding aspects to popular music to the base. For example, the swing era took inspiration from classical music with jazz orchestras and heavily orchestrated parts of the music. This popular influence can be seen in most parts of jazz that are more popular. With the evolution coming back to jazz nowadays, this shows that jazz is not dead in the way that people think it is. It still has evolution and room to grow. This can also be applied to pop music. Absolutely no one would consider pop music to be a dead music genre, but there are more similarities than when first perceived. In their report done by Joan Serra, Alvaro Corral, Marion Begonia, Martin Haro, and Joseph Lee Arcos for NCBI, there was use of computer programs to measure the evolution of pop music in the past years. Specifically, this measured the progression of contemporary Western pop music. By using pitch code words, frequency-based rankings, and pitch frequency distributions, it is seen that there has been a sort of blockage or no evolution in contemporary Western pop music in the past 50 years. Trends have shown that pitch code words, or code words depending on frequencies on particular notes, have followed the same pattern. Frequency-based rankings are shown to be the same throughout the years, and pitch/frequency distributions both follow universal patterns. There's a more scientific explanation for this too. It is common knowledge that people generally prefer repetition in their lives. Repetition carves familiar and rewarding paths in the human brain, which allows for people to anticipate and participate in the phrases that we listen to. This repetition is what basically makes popular music so popular, with the continuous straight backbeat, the famous pop music chord progression, continuous repetition of phrases produced. So what does this have to do with pop music being dead? What this shows is the lack of evolution that led to people believing jazz is dead. Although this is different, as pop music has always been like this, and jazz has been more prone to evolution. Without progression and blending with other elements, the music genre can become oversaturated, and will then become defunct and out of style, leading it to being dead. Of course, there are outliers, but for the most part, pop music has stayed the same. With jazz starting to influence pop music more and more, and jazz becoming more linked with pop music's blandness, it is fair to say that the jazz scene beyond its traditional roots has room to evolve plenty and honestly should gain more attention than ever. It has room to make pop music more interesting and should be more appreciated because of it. The consensus that jazz music should not be popular by conservative viewers of jazz is giving it a disservice to what it truly deserves. Therefore, pop music's overall blandness and lack of evolution should encourage the jazz scene to gain more attention. But one subject I abstained from mentioning before, and is debatably more important than the rest, is the education aspect of this music. Looking back at Wynton Marsalis, he is the leader of the most prestigious jazz college in all of the US, Juilliard. Although Wynton's ideals are based in respect of the roots of jazz and the lack of evolution in jazz, opening the doors for the younger generation allows for the evolution to come more naturally. A couple examples recently are artists like Julius Rodriguez and Jeffrey Miller. These two recent Juilliard graduates went on to not only play traditional jazz with professional orchestras, but to create their own music merging hip-hop, R&B, and jazz. This is proof of modern musicians innovating on the genre by using a strong understanding of traditionalism and the roots of jazz. With the continual evolution of jazz by the youth, this is influenced by the encouraged teaching of jazz. This encouraged teaching of jazz can be found in more than just colleges. It can be found in many public and private school systems, with jazz band classes being added as a regular class for many schools, joining the classical repertoire that was founded in schools much earlier. There are also festivals and competitions clearly meant for high school and college bands, some of the famous being Essentially Ellington, the Mingus Jazz Festival, and the Monterey Jazz Festival. Possibly the most popular jazz band in the Monterey Jazz Festival is the Next Generation Jazz Orchestra, a jazz orchestra featuring the top high school jazz performers in the nation. Just a look at the almost professional level of music playing coming from these young adults is extraordinary, to say the least. These festivals are a testament to the thriving jazz community under the popular music scene. Without considering the evolution of jazz as an attachment to popular music, we can still look at the thriving education in the youth to promote jazz and keep it relevant, similar to classical music. No one would consider classical music to be dead because of the continual education and audience for classical music. The genre still has a wide audience, and this is largely in part to the education system promoting that music as an art form. Jazz music is kind of the same, without the wider support found in classical music. As proven before, jazz music needs the support not only for pop music, but to keep a generation of jazz musicians able to innovate on the genre. This is why jazz should gain more attention. With an enhanced focus on education, jazz can influence so much more music and become what it needs to be. A genre that has impact in many ways. With jazz being given more and more attention in recent years, its thriving community and its cultural impact make it so the genre cannot be considered dead in the modern era. With the continual evolution of jazz through artists like Leo P. and Kamasi Washington, through the development of pop music depending on jazz as a sort of impactful add-on to it, and with the focus of jazz education becoming more and more prominent, jazz is far from dead. But it all goes back to the simple question, what is music to you? You can't force others to like a music genre, but you can influence the way you perceive a genre. In the end, the argument is not whether or not jazz is dead. It's if the music still has the power to influence people. Jazz's influence lies way deep in many people's hearts, as I'm sure any music genre does. Looking back, jazz shouldn't be defined by certain parameters. Pop music shouldn't be either. Looking back further, what matters to me is the expression of music and how it makes someone feel. The way people view music can be vastly different from how someone else may. With the way music can influence different people, it's important to know how memories shape how we view music. Viewing music as a way of expression can be formed from memories of people playing music with much expression that you can feel their emotion. Viewing music as just pretty melodies that make you feel happy can sprout from memories of feeling emotionally drenched and using music as a way to cope. Viewing music as a form of cultural expression can come from memories of music being heavily built into cultural or religious events. This way, music can be some sort of antidote for people. These antidotes may not be what shapes music for you, but it most certainly shapes music for someone, and that's really all you can ask for. That's the point of music, really. To do something more than just be pretty melodies. To be a way for the listener to connect with the music. This is when music utilizes its most powerful tool, a memory.